So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the work we're doing on the IA team here at inviCRO, but Bill asked me to give a little introduction as well to the IA team and also how we interact with software. So at inviCRO, we're basically responsible for any of the quantitative analysis that's performed, and that's for studies that we run internally, or we have a number of groups who acquire a lot of their own data and send it to us, and we perform the analysis. As such, we're really a very, very heavy user of our own software tools, including the VivoQuant and the IPACS. Some numbers to that: last year, we posted from the VivoQuant over 300,000 anatomical ROIs to the IPACS, and this year we're on pace for more than 500,000. We work really closely with the software team. So we're a team, the IA team is a team of about 20 people, mostly physicists, engineers, mathematicians, and we have three people that are really shared members across the IA and software department. So we have a really tight and close link there. I think one of the things that both Gabe and Bill alluded to is that in a lot of ways we're kind of an advance guard for a lot of the emerging modalities or emerging technologies that we're working with at inviCRO. So, I mean, to that end, I'm going to talk here. I'm going to just show up very quickly, kind of go through a quick hit of some maybe preclinical analysis, things that we've been doing. But and that's historically been our bread and butter, but we're really expanding. We've been doing a lot more clinical analysis and clinical data analysis, so I think that's something that you can see and you're already starting to see with the discussion of like tracer kinetic modeling and those sorts of tools being put into doing a lot of dosimetry, things like that, for clinical data, you know, between the VivoQuant and the IPACS. That's definitely something coming, and then also in the other direction, so a lot more histology and microscopy type of data analysis that's coming across our plates, which means that it's sort of a forecaster of what will be coming downstream to the VivoQuant. So, you know, in that same vein, we're responsible for a lot of the algorithm and tool prototyping. I think some of the tools that have already been mentioned really got their, you know, sort of got their legs underneath them on the IA team, and then they really get made mature and robust and deployed with the help of the software team. So we're working with them to transition those types of tools, both large and small. And then we also help a lot. You know, we're a relatively large team, and so and we're using the software every day, so we do a lot of testing and validation and QC of those tools in the VivoQuant. And so with that introduction, I'm going to now talk about really just sort of so I'm going to skip these. I should have been hidden already. I'm going to talk about just a couple topics here. So one of them, and I apologize, folks who are at the WIMIC may have seen some of these slides, but from the image processing side, I think as a lot of folks here know, image registration is one of the big tools we have in our toolbox. And so I'm going to talk about a few different types of image registration and show some examples of that. And then also just hit on a couple highlight things that we've been working on. One other note there, I think that you'll see we use the VivoQuant really heavily on our team. We also work outside the VivoQuant and I think probably do a lot of back and forth between the VivoQuant and other tools. And so I'll try to point that out a little bit here as we go, sort of where we do those things. So if we think about image registration, I'm going to touch on, I'd say, four different even kind of classes of image registration. The first being temporal registration, which is one, I think motion correction is probably the most common example there. You know, an example is shown here on the bottom where we have dynamic PET data, and maybe due to respiration or just anesthesia or something, there's a little motion. The arrows here aren't pointing to anything specific in terms of the structure or anything, but they're more just to help draw your eye and show how there's slight drift in the patient. We're trying to address that here. A second type of registration is multimodal registration. That would be what you just heard the previous speaker discuss, where you're using CT to PET or MR to SPECT, something like that. I'm also going to mention something about population or cross-subject registration and section registration. So here's an example of what I would call a temporal registration still, but it's more of a slow temporal registration, and that the time points here you see are 5 minutes, 5 hours, and 20 hours. So the animals were removed from the scanner in between each of these time points, but then we wanted to apply this novel compartmental model specific to this study at the voxel level as much as possible. So this was this is an image registration test that was accomplished in VivoQuant. We had a Vivo script to do this work. I think TJ worked heavily on this project. And, you know, there was a balance. There was some, there were, as I think everyone here can imagine, there were some interesting trade-offs between how accurately we could register these tumors when they were, you know, when the animals were removed and put back, and how we balanced that with the ROI that was segmented and making sure that we had confidence that those voxels lined up, and also how much smoothing we had to introduce to sort of account for variance in noise and registration. But that was published earlier this year. Multimodal registration. So we mentioned this. This is kind of the most common way that we think of it. I wanted to show a couple other examples. So multimodal doesn't always have to be maybe anatomical to nuclear medicine. Here's an example of different MR contrast images that are that were all co-registered to one, in this case, the MP-RAGE as an anatomical reference. So that is an example of a multimodal registration done in VivoQuant. Here's example from an ex vivo imaging workflow where we had a histology registered to a digital photograph, whole body. And then here's an example. I think this is something that kind of in that emerging area that we're seeing more and more of is groups that want to co-register data from maybe seemingly disparate modalities or at least disparate sort of scales. So here we're looking at in vivo SPECT data co-registered to, or at least in a certain sense, co-registered to histology data. So what we did was we used the Bregma space as kind of the fixed coordinate system or reference coordinate system. And we looked at the area of the, you know, A-beta hotspot staining on the histology and how that correlated just at the slice level for the same sort of slab through the SPECT image in terms of the whole percent ID per gram just in that hemisphere. And we saw, actually, I think it's a relatively small sample size, but we were seeing what looked like pretty promising correlations there. And this was published a couple of years ago. So the next kind of registration would be population registration. This you'll see again, and you heard mention of the whole body atlas tool. These are really kind of in the family of multi-atlas segmentation approaches. So this could be one where we're taking a bunch of different data sets from different subjects, whether they be human in this case or animal, and mapping them to a common unbiased reference space. And then we can do a lot of operations within that space or map data to that space and then back from that space into the original data space. And that's a really powerful tool, especially I think when we have really complex regions that we have to generate, and we'll touch on that later. This is just kind of building on that point that then if we have this template, we can take additional data sets that come in and map them all to that space in which we want to operate. And this is an example. This was a poster at the recent WMIC conference earlier this month where we used that approach to help. One thing we like to do is then we could look at voxel-wise comparison maps at the group level. So what you actually see here in panels A and B are group level average images for two different groups at a specific time point. These are AUC maps from dynamic data. But once we have them in the voxel level, then one, if they're in the same space, then it makes it easier to do kind of qualitative comparison. But then also we could do voxel-wise statistical analysis with the appropriate multiple comparisons corrections, again, in this template space and start to get maps of where we're really seeing. And that's a nice complement to some of these atlas approaches. Right, because we can look at a predefined anatomical atlas to sort of pull out at the region level, but it can also be nice if, you know, the mouse or rat doesn't know what this atlas is, so that, you know, the drug doesn't. So there could be regions that aren't specific to a particular atlas region, and these kind of approaches let us see maybe those patterns that fall outside that predefined atlas box. The last type of registration I'm just going to touch on here is what we're calling section registration. So this is something that mostly comes up for us in these cryo imaging modalities. So we've been doing a lot of we also call it block face tomography. So if you have a subject or a piece of tissue blocked and then we'll have it mounted and have just a digital camera mounted above the block. And as we remove sections, we can take digital photographs of that block. And then also we can take maybe fluorescence images off the surface of the block, or transfer those sections and perform autoradiography or some other kind of histological imaging. And what we often need to do then is we want to take those sections and turn them back into a three-dimensional stack. And maybe due to the block shifting around or the blade not returning to the same home position, something like that, we get some variation. And so we'll need to perform registration of these sections to one another. And that can be done using the fiducials that you see on this image or mutual information. Sometimes if deformation can be introduced in the transfer process of those sections, then we have to use some more sophisticated methods, which sometimes are really hard to get to work. So this is an example, actually, of one of these. This is actually a fluorescence reconstruction from these surface fluorescence images at very high resolutions. This is a wrap. In addition to the registration, we do some corrections for subsurface fluorescence in this case, but I think you can see already just in the two images to the right that we're able to get, it's all ex vivo, of course, but pretty high resolution fluorescent image data, which is quite powerful. So this is an example where I think some of these techniques really came together, and so I thought it was a nice one to highlight. So this was for looking at a pancarpal arthrodesis model in a canine. These were large hounds, like 30 kilogram hounds. So they had a surgery to put a metal plate in to fuse sort of the ankle bones. And then there was a putty that was put in with some sort of bone growth protein co-labeled with both iodine-124 and iodine-125. And what we did here was the top right, you see an image of co-registered data. Again, this is sort of both multimodal and temporal image registration. This was a really fun one to do because that massive metal plate made it really easy to co-register everything. This is out to 2 weeks in vivo with I-124. And then once the I-124 decayed, at the bottom left, you can see those are planar scintigraphy images with the I-125 out to 5 weeks, still in vivo. And we were able to use some image processing to get normalized percent injected dose curves in vivo all the way out to 5 weeks for estimating things like mean residence time. There was a high dose group and a low dose group here. After that, the subjects were taken down, and the plate was removed, and we followed that up with this autoradiography and surface block imaging, which provided complementary information in the sense that we got much higher resolution images. This is again of the I-125, and we could really localize where that signal, where signal remained in that joint space. And then we could also use that to make these, I think, really nice. Again, this was all done, the visualization certainly all done in the VivoQuant here, and a lot of the registration to see where these things went. And one of the real powerful features of this study was this had been done in the past and used 50 hounds, and we were able to get the same information from 10 hounds in this longitudinal in vivo study. Okay, so moving on past just general image registration to a few other examples. This is an example of a seeded region drawing algorithm fully implemented in the VivoQuant with vivo scripting. It's semi-automated in the sense that the user just goes through and clicks on the vertebrae to seed it. We use just Hounsfield unit thresholding to get the bone, and then a series of image dilations and image erosions, and followed by some region mapping in the last step. It's a little hard to see, and I don't know if I have, do I have a pointer? Oh, here we go. There are some little bits and pieces that are misaligned to a certain vertebrae, and we were able to use vivo scripting to identify those small pieces, typically at the back of the spine here, and map those to the correct vertebrae. Now, this was a case where I think we probably could have made this fully automated for the human, but we wanted to apply this technique to multiple species, because you can imagine, well, this is nice. It doesn't, for us at least, doesn't come up that often, but we get a lot more rat and non-human primate data for which this could be useful. So that was one of the nice things about this technique. Still within the VivoQuant, we were able to translate it across multiple species. So this is showing using that same vivo scripting approach for doing non-human primate, the human, and then the rat, which is shown there. Yeah. And then the figure. Okay. So this was this is kind of touching on, just as an introduction, people are familiar, I think, with the whole body atlas tool and this multi-atlas segmentation approach that has been deployed in the VivoQuant. We use it internally for a variety of other functions. So it's closely related to or similar registration techniques can be used to implement something called deformation or voxel-based morphometry. This was a study in which we were looking at the relative differences in growth or specific brain regions over time. So this is another area where it's kind of this voxel-wise analysis complemented the atlas analysis very nicely. So we were able to look, for example, the cortical region of the atlas clearly spoke to one group having a decreased volume, but we were able to map it on the voxel level here, I think very clearly, as you can see. So the blue here is indicating regions over time in which there was volume loss. And then we have this sort of movie on the right that shows that. So this is a nice technique. And these techniques are used, I think, most heavily in the brain. But this, there was a case that I think was a neat one, working with one of our scientific collaborators who's here, where we were able to apply similar techniques in the gastrocnemius muscle, which was tricky. So one of the real challenges there was the brain is nice because it's in the skull. It's rigid, right? The calf muscle is really squishy, and if you're not careful with image positioning, then those sorts of, if that calf is pushed up against the side of the bed, then that's going to kind of sink you. So we actually used the 3D printer in our laboratory to print very specialized beds for this project. Here we did a test, quite a bit of test retest with that bed, just to see how consistently we could image these calves, segment the volumes, and make sure that there was little change in the volume, and it worked quite well. So then, now that we had some confidence at least that the calf was being imaged in the same anatomical position every time, we could use these techniques. And here, we created this template, and then the ROIs were segmented manually on the template, and this worked pretty well because it's a relatively smooth shape, the calf muscle. And then we used the inverse transforms to map that template ROI back to the original space for each subject, so that we could look at the individual subject volumes over time. The bone segmentation was separate, so that's why the bones are identical in these two figures to the right. But I think one of the things that's nice here is there was relatively thick slices. So, and you can see that in how blocky kind of this looks in three dimensions. It can be tough, so that means a manual observer really needs to segment each slice individually. That can be tricky to do consistently. With getting back to the point of sort of even intra-observer variability from slice to slice, and that's one of the things that I think this technique is nice for. And you can sort of convince yourself of that if you look to the right here, that there's a little more variation or choppiness. I don't know, high spatial frequency, however you want to think about it, in the manual ROI. And you get a little more of a smooth shape, which you would expect physiologically in the population-based approach. So, these are techniques that I wouldn't say they're they take a little massaging to get to work well, but I think there's a lot of value there, especially in combination still with sort of manual QC and review. Other things we're looking at, cortical thickness segmentation. This is something that we were doing recently in we've been doing a lot of work in canines, and this was something that was recently implemented, which I think is a nice technique commonly used in humans, but I don't know that I'd seen it in canines before. Similarly, I think an exciting new area that people are getting interested in is quantitative susceptibility mapping. So this is shown on an example reference human data set just from the literature publicly available, but we've also been doing this work on canines, and this is, I think, a nice image processing problem with the phase unwrapping. And then another thing, so we recently acquired the rights to Ulta Blue Prime. I don't remember, but that I just get the image data. But this is a kidney, very nicely showing the vasculature, and so we've been working quite a bit to start building out our tools for analyzing this kind of data, so making maps of vessel radius, spending a lot of time reviewing the literature and thinking up new means for measuring vessel tortuosity. This is a popular metric in this space. One of the things one of the developers on my team has been looking at are are sort of what are the different metrics out there that people are using, and he's actually devised the, essentially an intrinsic and scale independent analog for all of those metrics. So we've been spending a lot of time sort of trying to understand those mathematics and what these metrics mean physiologically. And then, you know, this all feeds into reporting. So I use this as an example of there are a lot of metrics that you can pull from this really rich kind of vascular data. And so this is one of our, we produce a lot of these summary PDFs that have images and, you know, across all individual subjects. And this is one where you can see this list over here on the left are all the different sort of metrics that we're pulling out for, you know, tortuosity or skeletonization or the radius or just various sort of combinations of those metrics. And you can see there are 37 pages to this PDF. So those are all, each page of this PDF is a different representation of one of those metrics for one subject. Along those lines, is this on?
Should be.
Okay. So just in terms of fun, we'll see if this works. It might break everything.
WebEx people
will go ahead. WebEx people will be unhappy?
If we're not connected.
Oh, okay. Well, let's see if this link works. This is work with, we do a lot of DCMRI and PHMRI type of analyses as well. And these are some of the visualizations that I think are kind of nice. So this matrix is, you don't have to worry about the text, but these are all different brain regions. And this is a way to visualize, if we're doing, let's say, functional connectivity analysis, the reordering of those brain regions to show different connected network components, you know, via a clustering or their actual connectivity based on some thresholding parameters and or you know ICA, whatever you're using for doing that kind of analysis. Now I can go back. I'm almost done. This is just another visualization. This is actually one of our pipelines for PHMRI analysis. Just showing a lot of image processing steps, which I think is nice. But this is a pretty one. So again, it's maybe hard to read. These are all different brain regions around the outside. And at the bottom here, we have a correlation threshold, which can be adjusted. And then if you go to any region, it'll show you the green, any line indicates that this region, in this case, the left supramarginal gyrus, is correlated above the threshold of 0.6 with all these other regions. And a green line means that those regions all belong to the same network, and a red line means that this region correlates with that region, but they belong to different networks in a connectivity scheme. So, you know, these are the sorts of things that we like to think about and in terms of how to present a large amount of maybe complex data. And then, of course, it's a huge team effort between software and IA. I think we're probably 30 members or more now. So it's and there are a lot of people contributing to all this. And so I just want to thank them all and thank you for coming and your attention.
Thanks, Jacob. Any questions from the audience or?
Yeah.
How many of these are available for users?
In terms of for
registration.
So the, you know, a lot of them and a big push is going to the formal board registration is really being, I think, most actively worked on now. Gabe could correct me if I'm wrong there. And then I think he mentioned, so the CQuant and the CFT. So those are the sort of 3D autoradiography and 3D fluorescence approaches. Those are on the roadmap, and that's where a lot of that section registration comes in. I think one thing that we've not fully tackled, just being honest, is how to approach the group level analysis problem within Vivo Quant. That's a bit of a hairy one that I don't know that we've really hit upon a solution yet. That's an area where we still sort of often step outside. For the population-based registration, the Whole Body Atlas tool is there, and that's an example. And sort of building onto extensions of that is very possible. Group level analysis is something that I think is a little more amorphous still in terms of how we deploy that. Yeah?
Could you say this a little bit about users coming up with interesting processing techniques, perhaps like edge detection or a filter that you don't have? Can they be exchanged from user to user, or can you absorb them and make them available in your full package, or do you get only take the idea and then implement it yourself? On which level do you accept user or develop algorithms?
I think we would develop them. I'd kind of like to let the they might be happy to take them because we'll just run them locally, no problem. But I think maybe from a deployment standpoint, I'd like to defer a little bit to the software team.
In general, we try to generalize. If you do customized solutions, we try to generalize and work out with the customer the more general solutions, which then includes their particular tool they need. But we also have people that have developed their just remembering people having special moving filters that we then included their version that were proprietary and would not be available for the public.
Would not be available.
Yeah. So we are open to working with this, but in general we prefer, and many companies actually are pretty open to that also, and sharing if they have found something, and then we can actually put it into the tool and make it available to everybody. But it's on a case-by-case basis.
Mm-hmm. And I would think that depending on how directly it gets plugged in, probably depends on how it's then implemented. If it's in C++ or through some ITK package, it might be more, or has a library, it might be more directly integratable, I would guess, than if it's currently only implemented in MATLAB or something like that. That would require more development to get into a deployed package.
So do you have call-outs to MATLAB script from your...
We do sometimes call MATLAB from the Vivo script. From Vivo scripting, and that's been something a couple people on my team do with some regularity. Gabe, do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, sorry for running away
from you guys. Gabe, maybe you want to come up because then the mic's over here for people on the online.
To speak to that, it's not overly common, but we do have an ability to call sort of MATLAB functions or MATLAB scripts from Vivo script. There's no direct sort of memory sharing there, so you typically have to like save the data, load it back into MATLAB, watch it do its thing, save it back out, and so the communication there is sort of that level of complexity. But to that end, to make things fully automated, that's usually when we do that thing. So if you want to run a very sophisticated pipeline that involves hooks into other software, this would be the way you do it. And typically you expect a little bit longer of a running time for that.
Yeah. I would say that has been one of the major drivers of for us getting implementation in VivoQuant for certain things. We do have support internally, some of our internal tools for going back and forth between the VivoQuant and MATLAB, and also the IPACs even in MATLAB, and passing data back and forth, but they do tend to be less, there's not as strong of a connection as there is between the VivoQuant and the IPACs. So wherever possible, we try to find ways to work within that VivoScript framework or integrate the tools more directly into the VivoQuant so that we can translate those analysis into the VivoQuant. And it's been, I think, amazing over the last few years from where I sit to see how many of our processes and tools have migrated from MATLAB into being fully done on the VivoQuant.
And MATLAB is a great tool for prototyping. That's why it's used and really very often. And also, if you work with a customer, we work on the prototype, make proof of concept, and then we decide if it's a tool that is of general interest, should we try to get it over and make. You know, then the hard work starts with the software team because that's something that works, and getting into something that works for everybody almost as much work as coming up with the tool itself.
Yeah. Any questions from people on the WebEx? Again, you can provide in the chat. Well, if you think of any questions, Jacob, I have one. I always enjoy seeing the slide on the cap puzzle.
Yeah.
And how that influenced study design and image acquisition. So maybe if you could comment on how often it comes up internally with your team and that after processing the first study or a pilot study, how that information in the analysis can influence and guide future study design and
acquisition. Yeah, that's just a pretty common occurrence for us. So people will just upload a big zip file full of data and say, here's what we acquired and this is what we'd like to do. And we'll start looking at it and say, okay. And so we'll do what we can and then come back and say, if you really wanted to answer this question, you may want to consider, you know, this kind of modification, or maybe we should do this. You know, there are certain things you always want to do whatever you can on the back end, on the kind of the post-processing side, to recover as much as possible from whatever the data has been acquired. But it's always often worthwhile to have this feedback loop, again, to the laboratory team, and we do this a lot both within our own organization and with our scientific collaborators to say, you know, here are some things that we think might have benefited the analysis on the acquisition side, because often if you can tackle a problem earlier, farther upstream, it's going to make the results downstream that much better. So just it comes up a lot.
Yeah. Looks like we have one question here. First one from the chat, all right.
Ah, great. How VivoScript, the question is, can you please comment on how the use of VivoScript has influenced throughput on your team?
Yeah, I mean, it's actually, I think that so there are a few ways. I mean, I think the one that we think of the most often or most commonly is in terms of the actual image processing itself, because that's how we're thinking about the VivoScript and how we can hook into some of the image registration and segmentation tools to generate regions of interest. And that is certainly a way that it's improved automation, improved throughput, because we can add that level of automation, but we often still need, you know, a manual QC. Again, the previous speaker hit on that as well. I think one way that doesn't get brought up as often, that at least for us has really, that really, really benefits throughput, is the relationship between the VivoQuant and the IPACS and the meta information in those places. So we use VivoScripting very heavily to generate quality control images or MIPS for every data set in a study. And then also to take the regions of interest that are generated, post that data to the IPACS, and then use VivoScript to pull back down that information and spit it out to summary spreadsheets that we can then pipeline through our tools for plotting and statistical analysis. So I think that's a way in which we really heavily use VivoScript to remove people physically copying and pasting numbers from spreadsheets and things like that. So everything's on the IPACS, and we can pull it all down and get it into spreadsheets without having someone touching it at that phase. And I think that's a way we don't bring up a lot, but that internally we use really, really heavily to increase throughput.
Yeah, and to that end, I'll just add that it can really help make the workflows much more robust. As Jacob alluded to, you can kind of, if you're not so familiar to VivoQuant, or you don't want people sort of navigating around too much, there's a wealth of tool sets there. A VivoScript can kind of focus your workflow. It can take you from, you know, this tool to that tool. It can open up the dialogues you need for the input that you need, and it kind of prevents the user from just forgetting to do a step or something like that, which really has helped us having to avoid going back and sort of fixing things.
So that, just building on that a little bit, it's maybe not so much on throughput in this case, but as we're starting to get more into, let's say, generating dosimetry estimates for first-in-human data, and we want to have more closed workflows, that's something where we're finding this to be, again, really nice, because we're able to really use VivoScripts, maybe for some things that you would think can be done very mindlessly, which is kind of a danger manually, because that's when you might make a mistake. Instead, we can have VivoScripts to do this thing, so we can take the sort of reconstructed data that we receive and have a chain of VivoScripts that pipeline all the way through to get us the final output that's maybe going to Olinda or something. And so we have a really nice closed system that we can have sort of an audit trail for every step of the chain and can reproduce completely exactly A to Z. And that's somewhere where it's maybe not a throughput thing, but for a kind of peace of mind and SOP and protocol and all those fun things, from that standpoint, it's really powerful.